Please join me in welcoming Bertha David Sington. David, congratulations on what I think is a heartwarming and heart-wrenching film. I'll give everyone a chance to decompress a little bit. So the way we're going to run this is I'll ask a couple of questions and then I'm sure you'll all have lots to ask David also. So I just wanted to start with the basics, really. And how did you first encounter Nick's story? And I suppose what drew you to it?
Well, look, the answer is sitting right there. It's my colleague, Christopher Riley, who I've worked with Chris a lot on various different projects. He has a kind of sort of truffle hound's nose for a good story. And I think that, well, Chris could probably tell you, but since I've got the microphone and it's attached to a wire, I better. I think that Nick came over to the UK a couple of years after he got out of prison, and he was campaigning against the death penalty. He tried to organise, was actually quite effective in a way, an economic boycott of Philadelphia by British companies because of their attitude on the death penalty. And he spoke at the Palace of Westminster, and he did some media. And I think Chris heard him interviewed on the radio and then went to a couple of events and kind of saw, I think, that there was a real possibility of something quite remarkable from this person in terms of their story and also the way that they told their story and the way they spoke. And so then Chris, we had recently finished a film together called In the Shadow of the Moon at that point, and we were looking around for something else. And Chris said this might be the next one. And so then we had to persuade Nick to agree to be filmed. And actually, we had to negotiate with him, and Gareth Cadwallader, who's a founder with me of our company, Docs Productions, helped in that regard to sort of just tie up all the knots with Nick. And so that's sort of, it's, I give full credit to Chris. He brought it to me, and I just went, yeah.
Brilliant. And, you know, his is a mind-bending story of twists and turns and sort of, you know, leaves you with unbelievable gasps. I suppose at the beginning we see the words, you know, his story has been independently verified.
Yeah.
And I just wonder, you know, while you were interviewing him or in talking or researching, was there any moment that you sort of, you know, wondered of the veracity of what he was telling you, or is that statement at the start purely so that we're left understanding that what we will hear is the truth?
Well, that's why we put it in, because I think, you know, the story is incredible in a way, also sort of typical but incredible, because what's typical about the American justice system is also incredible in some ways. The process was that, having agreed with Nick that we were going to make the film, I had my colleague Sarah Kinsella basically research his story. And in fact, he gave us boxes and boxes and boxes of material, which we went through, you know, court records, police records, arrest records, newspaper articles, and so forth. So we went through all of that, both before the interview, prepping me for the interview, and also afterwards, to kind of try to corroborate independently and objectively the stories that he was telling. And the other thing is, we actually did two interviews with Nick. So we did 2 days with him, which were very, I mean, we built a set which was like a cell, as you can see. And the interview setup was quite particular. Nick couldn't really see anything. It was all dark, but there was this light on me. So that was really all he could see. So this person he's talking to. And I think it was designed to evoke a cell, and it really worked. I mean, I think we freaked the poor guy out, actually. And he was, we were 5 minutes into this thing, and I realized it wasn't really an interview. He was sort of reliving the whole experience with a great deal of very visible emotional tears. He was going through the anger, the pain, the sorrow, some of the humor, all the rest of it. And we took us 2 days to go through his whole life story. And then I realized that was a bit intense, really. And so we then came back several months later, and we did the whole story again in a different way. Actually, the songs are very important to him, and he talks about these songs being the songs of his life. So we went through his life by song, as it were. We got them all recorded on a mixtape and sort of played them, and we talk about them, and went through the story that way. And that was a more measured performance. But the interesting thing in terms of veracity is that we were going over the same ground, and you know, there was no, absolutely no inconsistency whatsoever between the two stories. So yeah, I mean, I think that you can't, I mean, I think that the film's about somebody learning to tell their own story, learning to master language and becoming articulate and telling a new story about themselves, both to themselves and to the world. And so I think it is rehearsed in Nick's mind. I mean, I think that, you know, right at the end there, the very last thing, he has this long passage where he's talking about coming back onto the mental ward block. And that's a completely uncut sort of monologue, absolutely perfect, with no ums and ahs, with incredibly dramatic pauses. He pauses in exactly the same place. It's a fantastic piece of theatre, if you like. I can assure you that is entirely unrehearsed. That is exactly how it came out like that. And, you know, obviously not everything in 22 hours of material is like that, but I think he you know, spent all this time thinking about things in his cell and remembering and turning his instance of his life into some anecdotes in a way, turning them into stories. So I think it's true, but it's also a performance. But then that is just like everything in life. I mean, I think we have to, we actually perform ourselves. We create a story about ourselves and who we are and what we do, and then we project that into the world. That's what we all have to learn to do. And what kind of story you project changes your life. It makes you a different kind of person. That's what it's about, really.
Yeah, I was going to say that the theatricality and that sort of real dramatic element is incredible, and wondering how much that was directed or was just, you know, his sort of sensibility.
It's all me. Well, I think, you know, we kind of, yeah, you have an interview with somebody, and I sort of thought, well, I don't want the audience to really know exactly where he is, so. You know, I don't think I can go over to America and find a prison cell, so we'll build something like a prison cell. So that wasn't necessarily a decision to make something very theatrical, but it was seemed like a sensible space, you know. And, you know, I think Chris and I, you know, thought that we would make a more conventional film with the main protagonist being Nick, but other interviewees and archive footage and newspapers and blah, 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 blah. But once, I said, 5 minutes into the interview with Nick, I realised it really wasn't an interview, it was a kind of performance that he was reenacting himself, his own story. And so we did 2 days, we waited some months, we came back, we did 2 more days. And I think at the end of that, we all kind of felt, well, do we actually have everything that we need in some way? I mean, other interviewees, are they really going to, how would you put another interviewee? Isn't the temperature going to drop? I mean, that's the thing when you're a director, there's this thing, I call it temperature, I guess, it's sort of emotional tone, register, but you've got to sort of control that through the film. You start in a particular pitch, you've got to hold it. I mean, television, factual television, documentaries, there aren't that many documentaries on television, but factual programming, you know how it often starts an incredible pitch. You know, this is the most important, amazing story, things are blowing up, people are swinging on ropes, or at the beginning, to kind of grab you in. And then you always have that terrible moment when the actual program starts, it's like, and so that's the sort of thing that you avoid. And I was thinking, so we'll have Nick, and we'll be all like this, and then we'll go to some policeman or some lawyer, and we'll go, so I thought, no, we have to try to do it as a one-man show, really. And of course, once we were thinking like that, it kind of made it impossible to raise any money for the film. So we were totally stuffed. And that's why it took so long to make.
How long was that?
Well, we did those interviews in 2007 and 2008. So then we tried to raise money based on extracts. And it was the same story, we'd get the same thing. Oh, it's marvellous, it's fantastic. You know, let me discuss it with my boss, with my colleagues, and then some months later, well, I don't know, we've done a lot of Death Row. I go, oh, come on, you haven't done anything like this. And then we went, after you've done that about 3 times, you realise actually, you know, in life I've realised with films, so either everybody wants it or nobody wants it. So once you've been turned down a few times, and you realise you're not going to raise money for it. then we thought about, well, maybe we could sort of do this as an animated film. Chris had this rather imaginative idea of doing an animated film, and we actually spent, I think it's probably in the end, a couple of years or 18 months, we actually took one bit of the film, which is where he gets arrested, and we sort of made that as part of an animated sequence. And it was very, very effective. But again, firstly, it was going to be very expensive to make. And secondly, I kind of wasn't super keen on the idea because I thought that the danger of animation was in the end we'd end up merely literally illustrating what he said. And I thought at that point it would be less powerful than the pictures that he evokes with his language. So at that point, we had sort of scratching our heads what to do. And I thought, well, the only way we're going to get this to work is we have to edit. We have to prove to ourselves, to everybody else, that we can tell the story. And then Chris managed to persuade his colleague at Imperial College, Robert Sternberg, who's sitting on the end here, who's the one of the three editors on this film. So we've had three editors. One worked for 3 years, one worked for about 3 months, and one worked for 3 days. And they all made a fantastically important contribution. David Fairhead worked for 3 months, and Horatio Keogh worked for 3 days. But Robert was the person who really, together with Chris, they went through the 22 hours of material and produced a kind of version, boiled it down to about a 2.5 hour, something like that, assembly, chronological assembly. And then I sort of worked on it with Robert and Chris to bring that down to 1.5 hour, still chronological. And then we showed that to some people and got some very interesting comments. One particularly important comment from John Batsek, who's a very distinguished producer, got 2 Oscars, so you take what he says very seriously. And he said, I liked it by the end. I was a bit slow at the beginning. I loved it from when he arrives in the prison. So then I thought, okay, let's. What happens if we start it in the prison? So then I was having a shower, actually. Showers are important in the film and important in the making of the film. And I always have my best ideas in the shower in the morning. So I was having my morning shower and thinking, if I start in the prison, how do you do it? And I sort of worked out the structure in the shower. It's pretty easy to do. And then went back to, I had a meeting with Chris and Robert, said, okay, this is what we're going to do. We're going to restructure the film. So Robert restructured it along those lines. And then we showed that at Sheffield as a work in progress. And then we were able to very relatively easily raise the money we needed to actually finish the film. But I think it's sort of, Robert's not just a film maker, he's a screenwriter as well, and I think he brought a sort of writer's sensibility to shaping the material into scenes with this kind of, so a lot of the rhythm and kind of structure of the individual scenes in particular is really Robert's work, and that's been preserved all the way from the earliest cut all the way to the final cut.
And those reveals really are impactful. At this stage, does anyone have any questions? I think we've got a roving mic somewhere up there. Any questions?
Somebody at the front.
I can speak loudly if you want.
Speak loudly.
I just wanted to know how Nick is now. What's he up to now?
He's actually moved back to the States. He's living in California. We'll see him next week because we have our New York premiere. He's coming to that. He came to the London premiere at the London Film Festival. He's worked a variety of different jobs. He's written a couple of books, autobiographical books. His jobs have been fairly ordinary, like he's worked in Next when he was here. He worked in B&Q, you know, it's like the guy getting stuff off the shelf is ex-Death Row. You spend all that time in Death Row and you're at B&Q. But the thing that he does that I think he likes to do the most and I think is the most valuable thing, and I hope he's going to do more of it on the back of this film, is he loves to go and talk to school kids. He goes to talk in prisons, and also he's actively involved in the cases of a couple of friends of his from Death Row. One guy in particular who I think is absolutely right, is definitely didn't do what he's meant to have done and is trying to, you know, help their appeals and fighting on their behalf. So he is sort of politically involved with the whole death penalty issue.
Any more?
Is there any form of compensation for the time he did
He got some money. He didn't get very much because I think the state of Pennsylvania took the view that, well, you definitely did that robbery and you got 35 years for that robbery. So you haven't been wrongfully imprisoned. He only got sort of compensation for the years between being sentenced to death and sort of escaping. So he did get something. I think he gave most of that to his family.
Was it difficult to talk him into discussing it? Did he talk about it much before? Because in the film, he was obviously really happy to be talking about it at the start of the film. So how glad he was to be able to talk about it.
I think that it was difficult. I said this to Nick. I say it to anybody who makes a film with us. Anybody who appears in a film, you're kind of putting yourself into somebody else's hands, because we can make you look good, we can make you look bad, we can make you look clever, we can make you look stupid. If we make mistakes, you know, I do films about science and things like that. If I have a scientist and the film gets the science wrong, people will think the scientist has got the science wrong. So you have to trust the person, and you have to literally, and in Nick's case, almost literally handing his whole life, almost literally into our hands. He handed over all this material, all the newspaper cuttings and, you know, letters that he'd written to lawyers and to his family, and all this material came to us, and we still have it, actually, all properly, nicely organised. And I actually said to Nick, can I send it back to you, because I'm paying for a story. So so I think that it was more, I had to get him to trust us and to give informed consent. So I think, you know, when Nick had been through a lot of situations where, you know, the world had sort of, people were not trustworthy in a sense, or he lost trust in people. So it was a bit of a slightly protracted business to get him to agree to that. But I think that once the process started, it sort of acquired its own momentum. He certainly told us things that he had not told before. So a lot of the stuff about what he actually did after he escaped, he'd not owned up to some of the things that he did. I mean, you know, that guy who, you know, lost his wallet, I mean, that's a crime for which Nick was never charged. So he fessed up partly because I pushed him on how did he manage to get to Florida, you know. So how did you get down there? What went on? But mostly I wasn't sort of asking him questions. I was just inviting him to sort of, and then, what happened next? And why was that? I mean, you don't really ask questions, I think. You're just there. Mainly what I was doing is visually responding to what he was saying, so that he had an audience, really. So it is a performance, and a performer needs an audience. And I was that audience. I was the only thing that he could see. But it was a very... Chris was there. It was I think you'd agree, very emotional, particularly the first couple of days of interviews. I mean, lots of tears. Nick was crying, I was crying, the cameraman was crying. You know? It's sort of like, it's very, very emotional at times.
Anyone else?
What was his reaction to seeing it? You watched it?
Yeah, I think what you see, oddly enough, so Nick gave us the interview in 2007, 2008, and then honestly we had very little contact with him for several years, and occasionally there would be a slightly irate email, what the hell has happened to this fucking film, you know, are you actually going to produce it? And so I think that I showed him the Sheffield version, that was this structure without pictures, at his house when he was still living in England at that point. So that was... interesting. I mean, he kind of he was very emotional watching it, and then he actually, when we got to near the end, that's when he had to go to the loo. I mean, I could tell that was an excuse. He didn't want to watch what was coming up, but he liked it very much at that point. And then so he saw it really for the first time at the London Film Festival. I was sitting next to him, and honestly, he spent half the film with his coat over his head. You know, he couldn't watch the screen. Partly because he said, that guy is scary, you know. So looking at yourself really big, you know, every pore visible. But he watched the whole film, and yeah, I know that he said some really wonderful things actually in the Q&A afterwards, which I won't repeat because it will make me even bigger headed than I am already. But he likes the film very much, yeah.
Anyone else?
Yes, this lady here.
I just want to ask a question about distribution. Obviously, it's a very long road getting a feature doc produced and actually taken up, as we well know. Does he have a particularly good distribution deal with you? Because it is his story. And without him, you haven't really got a film, have you? You could talk about death row inmates in another way, but it's very much his story. It's very particular to him. Have you done a good deal with him?
Yeah, I think he's got a very good deal.
Great.
So I won't tell you the details, but he's got a lot better deal than I have, because he's had money out, and all I've done is put money in. So, I mean, if we do very well, then I might get some money out. And if we do really, really well, Nick will get some more money out. But he's had an advance against receipts, so it'll have to do really well before he gets any more. As I repeatedly tried to make clear to him, don't expect any more. Okay. So, I mean, I think that's only fair. And as it was with Gareth that negotiated a deal. So, because obviously it's his life story in a way, it's his main asset is his story. But as I say, he's written a book and things like that. So, there was a person at the back.
Was it really only 18 hours of interview time?
I think it was about 22 in the end, 22 hours,
And you asked questions.
Yeah.
And he just responded straight away.
Yes. So it wasn't in any sense rehearsed. I mean, I deliberately didn't, which is my usual practice. I don't want to talk to an interviewee about the subject I'm going to talk to them about before I talk to them, because I want them to tell me stuff for the first time. But I usually would have a colleague prep. So in this case, it was Sarah, I think, Chris, I think, as well, sort of talked to Nick about his story beforehand. So they produced notes for me. So I sort of knew what the story was. So I kind of had internalized all that. I knew where we were going to go with the interview in broad terms and in some detail in some cases. But then you just go. He'd not talked to me about these things before, so he's talking to me for the first time, really, about this stuff. If you look at the rushes, there's very little, do you want to do that again? Occasionally, he would get all choked up or confused, and I'd say, look, calm down a bit, just start again. You said that, this happens, so start from there and go on. And then, but I had the whole story twice. So I had the whole story in the first couple of days. So again, we were doing about 5 or 6 hours, and then the next day, 5 or 6 hours. And then we did it, we had two more days, some months later, with a slightly different approach to the story. So the songs, as I said before, the songs are important. So we made a mixtape of the 10 songs, and we sort of went through it, played a song, and then tell me about what comes with that. So that was a sort of, gave us a different emotional register, because I knew that the emotional register of the first interview was just too full on. It was up at 11, as they say in Spinal Tap, most of the way through. I knew I needed stuff at 5 and 6. So that's what we got. We tried to do a slightly more toned down, try to keep hold of it. And of course, it was less emotional for Nick because he had told me that before. So each time you do it, it comes down a notch. So, but it's unrehearsed. It's not scripted in any way. We have taken, and Robert, as I say, is the guy who really was very important in this and the first person to really try to do this. We have taken that much transcript, 22 hours, and made a play from it. So it's like sort of playwriting, it's like screenplay, writing a screenplay, but from the material. So you're not free to write anything. And we didn't go back, we never recorded another word with him, we didn't record any extra little bits to join stuff up or anything like that. We just had that 4 days of material, and that was it.
It therefore seems to me that if one judges that 22 hours of interview, that really gives a lot of veracity to what he was saying.
Yes.
It's very difficult for anyone to make it up.
Yes, exactly. Particularly since it's 11 hours and then another 11 hours of the same story. And if it's inconsistency, you'll find it in there, definitely. Yeah, I mean, you can tell. I mean, I could tell talking to him. I think you can tell. It's very, very difficult to lie to the camera convincingly. And I think there's this fantastic story, I think, that Andrew, Oliver Sacks, the neurologist, There were some people who have this thing where they can't understand, they have a problem in their brains, they have a stroke or something. They can't understand language. So language just becomes gobbledygook to them. And he has this amazing story of a group of these people in a mental hospital, an asylum really, watching television and watching Ronald Reagan give a State of the Union address and rolling about the room laughing because they couldn't understand anything that he could say, but they could kind of see a fake performance. You know, somehow they were so attuned to the body language, the face, and so forth. And I think, you know, we are, as human beings, we've evolved to be super attentive to the way that another human face looks. It's the first thing that babies learn to recognize is a human face and then their mother's face. And, you know, they spend their formative years staring into a face. And we are subconsciously super aware of tiny little muscular movements, little things that give the game away. And, you know, I'm sitting there in the theater watching these very big close-ups. I always wonder, God, have I gone in too tight? You know, I don't think an actor, you will not see close-ups like that in fiction on the whole, because I think it's almost impossible for any but the very greatest of actors to hold a performance that tight, because we will see through it. We will see the acting. And so I think that to me is the ultimate proof of Nick's veracity, is that you can watch him full face and not think you're faking. So there were some other hands.
It was just really, it's very much so his story rather than a go at the American judicial system. Was it difficult to position it that way? Obviously, throughout the 22 hours, there must have been quite a lot of negative comments about that, and it comes across relatively neutral.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. You're quite right. I mean, a lot of the interview is about really appalling abuse that Nick witnessed between prisoners, between guards and prisoners, things that happened to him. The whole story of why it took so long to get DNA is a sort of scandal of prosecutorial misconduct. I mean, the reason why the first DNA test was inconclusive due to degradation is that quite improperly the prosecution essentially confiscated these slides from the lab and basically put them in a drawer rather than in a refrigerator and kept them there for several years, so that by the time he got court approval for the test, they'd decayed. And that was, I think, a completely deliberate attempt on the part of the prosecution to destroy evidence. And unfortunately, this sort of thing is all too common in the American justice system. But I think that, firstly, I didn't want to make that film, because that film, I've sort of made that film before, actually, because I produced a film and I directed, well, I did a series for the BBC when I worked at the BBC in the 90s about forensic science, and part of it was about the sort of abuses of forensic science. So I'd sort of done that myself before, and other people have done those sorts of stories very, very effectively. You know, we all remember Thin Blue Line, Errol Morris. But also that if you are doing a monologue, then there's a limit to how much you can accuse the system, the police, the prosecution, the prisons, without giving them some kind of opportunity to reply. And since I wasn't going to do that, I really wasn't free to do that, even if I'd wanted to do it. I would have had to have made a completely different film. And I felt that, but I think that, to me, almost the worst aspect of the American death penalty system as it's practiced in many states, and Pennsylvania is a very good example, is this very, very long period of time between conviction for the offense and eventual execution, if indeed it ever happens. Because when you are waiting 20 years to kill somebody, you're not killing the same person who did the crime. Even if they were guilty, they've changed. They're a different person now. And that's what this film's about, how somebody totally changes. Nick goes from being a liar, a thief, illiterate, junkie, total, utter, antisocial, pain in the ass. His parents can't stand him. They kick him out of the house. He belongs in prison. No question about it. He's an utterly worthless member of society.
Thank you.
but he converts him, changes himself into somebody I think is really quite admirable and worthy of respect and worthy of love, able to be married, be a father, be a functioning member of society, give things, not just take them. And I think, you know, he's not the only person that changes in prison. I mean, his is a particularly striking case. But that, to me, is the real injustice of the system. Not that they execute innocent people, which does happen for sure, but that by the time they get to execute people, they're executing, in some sense, somebody else. You know. So I think that it is an, if you like, you can take out of it a kind of critique of the death penalty in America, but we came at it obliquely. And that wasn't really our motivation for making the film. I think the film is about a universal human truth, which is that to be worthy of respect and to be worthy of love, you first have to respect yourself and, in a sense, love yourself. And those who are hateful are often, in the first place, hateful to themselves. They don't have any self-respect. They actually, in their hearts, they despise themselves and believe themselves to be worthless. And that's taken out on society. And it's a sort of vicious cycle. And Nick kind of has this revelation of love expressed under a brutal regime by Butch and Wesley singing to each other. And he sees that it is possible to have the finest feelings even in that world. And that's what he wants for himself. He wants to be someone that other people will love. And his whole story is, how does he get to be that person? And he finds himself, he finds a better version of himself through literature. And that, to me, is the story. So it's a story set in death row, but it's not really about death row. That could be in a number of different settings. Yes, Arliss.
What do you think Nick will say to the school children that he visits?
Learn to read. And I think that we did a little pro bono, Sarah, who worked on this, Sarah Kinsella directed for us. We did a little film for a charity called Springboard for Kids, which is well worth supporting. What they do is go into primary schools they have a little office, and kids that are having difficulty reading can be sent off for one-to-one teaching, and they have a very good a record of getting those kids back into the main class. And one of the things that they say to raise money, they raise a lot of money in the city, they go and dine bankers and stuff in these big, you know, the usual way that you raise money with a nice auction and the rest of it. And their pitch, which is very effective, is that basically the guy who's, you know, keying your BMW, you know, and nicking your stuff, if you go into prison, almost everybody in prison is functionally illiterate. Almost nobody who can read and write properly ends up in prison. So if we want to, you know, solve crime, one of the most effective ways is making sure that children can read and write.
Just
there.
So
I'm going to shout a bit. So you gave a brief description, quite a good description of what the film was about. Yeah. So I'm quite intrigued as to why you chose the title, that specific title, because it came up twice, I think, in his conversation. So I'm just kind of intrigued about why that choice of title.
Do you like the title?
I do, but I'm intrigued as to why.
Yeah, well, firstly, I like a title to spring out of the film. So it's a phrase used in the film, and our film that Chris and I did about the Apollo astronauts is called In the Shadow of the Moon, and that's a phrase which Gene Cernan uses. So I like that, for just to have it find a title in the film rather than imposing it on it, if you see what I mean. And so I guess there are two things about the title. One is, it sounds intriguing, it sounds like fiction, it sounds like it's a thriller in some sense. So you're kind of trying to convince people that they're not going to see and watch a boring documentary, but something interesting. So I think it's an intriguing title, I hope so. But also, the film is a sort of series of mysteries. You don't really know who this person is, why he's there. What do these pictures mean? And why is the film called The Fear of 13? And then it's about half an hour into the film when you understand why it's called The Fear of 13. So it's really the first question that's definitively answered. So I see it as a kind of little marker for the viewer. I don't know if you felt like this, you'd know better than me, that I am going to answer, we are going to answer all your questions, don't worry, you're going to get. And then the other thing about it is that it's to do with the moment when he's learning to read and mastering language. So to me, that is the heart of the film. That passage where he's talking about reading and reading books and learning, you know, the rule of 10 and all the rest of it, that's the heart of the film. That's the turning point. That's when he starts to become a different person. So I like it that the title focuses your attention on that moment. So that's why it's called Fear of 13. Yay.
Yes, what happened to Butch and Wesley?
I don't know, I'm afraid. That is a great story, isn't it? I have absolutely no idea. It's a kind of beautiful, tragic story. I sort of want to make a film about them, if I could find them, but it's like, I don't think even Nick knows what happened to them and what, even necessarily what, who they really were and all the rest of it. I like to think that eventually they work the system to get back together again, but who knows?
Is his mother still alive?
His mother, his parents were both alive, both lived to see him released, but they're both now dead. And I think that they kind of, oddly, I mean, Nick said, I mean, I didn't put it in the film because it's too on the nose, but he said, you know, prison saved my life, that's one thing. And I think it also, in an odd way, reconciled him to his parents, because obviously he had been an incredibly difficult child. I think because of this terrible thing that happened to him, then he becomes a drug addict. He had an incredibly destructive effect on the whole family, which is why they ended up sort of kicking him out. But on the day that the murder happened, he had a family dinner. His whole family were there. So they knew beyond any possibility that he did not do this crime. And it is astonishing to me that he was convicted of the crime, because there was no evidence whatsoever linking him to the crime. And he had a cast iron alibi. But the prosecution did to him what he, in a sense, had done to the unfortunate Jimmy Brisboys, which was they got another criminal, another person in prison to say, oh, they put him in this guy's cell, and then this guy came up and testified and said that Nick had said that he wasn't worried because he'd got his parents to give him an alibi. And I think what happened really with his story is that he'd sort of connected himself to the crime in some way by making up this story. And then they did a blood test, and his blood test matched the killer. And at that point, the police went, okay, he's our man. So they set about constructing a case against him. But it was incredibly flimsy. The trial lasted 3 days. It's the shortest capital murder trial in the entire history of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So it was like a total railroading thing, actually. Yes?
I just wanted to say, watching the film, for the first hour, I thought you got an actor.
Yes.
To play the part of Nicky. And I thought his word-perfect story and the fact that it was such a performance, for me, until I kind of realised and saw the mugshots and stuff, I thought, that's ruined it for me entirely. Did you find making the film ever that got in the way, ever at all, with the kind of
yes,
the truth?
Yeah, or? And absolutely did, that people thought that his performance was just too compelling to be a real person. Yeah, we had that. That's why we put, you know, the captions at the front, he agreed to be interviewed, his story's been verified. You know, short of saying, it's not an actor. You know, we're trying our hardest. I agree. And like, we've left in little stumbles and things that we could have taken out, because we don't clean him up, because those little stumbles sort of should indicate that it isn't an actor, because we would have gone, oh, okay, I know you've buffed your lines, you do it again. So, I mean, but I'm glad that it wasn't all the way through.
No.
Yeah, good. Well, that's why you put the mugshots in. It's, it's been our bugbear, actually. I mean, that's partly people said, we won't give you any money because he's too good, nobody will believe it. Yeah, okay, right. He's too boring, you're not giving me money. He's too good, you're not going to give me money, you know. So we're just somewhere in between, but anyway, yeah.
I think we just got time for one more.
At the back, yes?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's very unfortunate. It's a mistake I've made. That's the guy who closes the trunk. That's him. It's not Nick. So we had an actor sort of playing Nick.
That's confusing.
It is confusing. I'm sorry.
It wasn't actually.
Yeah, that's really confusing. So I apologize. And you know, if I could have my life over again, that's the one thing that I would change. Yeah, I know, maybe we should, I don't know. But it's so expensive to change it once it's finished. It's just, because you have to do the whole thing again, because it's all a digital file these days. It's not like it's going to snip that bit out. I have to remake the whole thing. But I am an idiot. Somebody should have, you know, kicked me.
And where next, finally, David? So where
well, now that I'm Dog Roof, who are wonderful distributors, and I want to thank them. They've been fantastic support for the film. They came in at rough cut, and they've really helped us not just get it out, but they had some very good advice about what we should do, should and shouldn't do in terms of some of the scenes in the film, which we ignored for a long time. I ignored. Chris wanted me to take out this scene. Anna from Dog Roof wanted to take it out. I kept it, and then until the film was finished, I looked at it, then I took it out, so we had to redo it. So that's partly what I'm redoing here. But anyway, Dog Roof are distributing. We are in cinemas from Friday. So they will want me to say, please tweet. If you like the film, please tweet about it. And if you don't like the film, please shut the fuck up. So, but anyway, please get the word out to your friends, relatives, you know, creditors, all that sort of thing. Sort of get it out. It'll be in cinemas on limited release from Friday the 13th, which is an auspicious day for us. And how limited that release is rather depends on how many people go and buy tickets. So if you want your friends to see it, you better get them to go and see it quickly. Otherwise, it'll be come and gone, you know, like so many films these days.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.